Today we're going to talk about still a little bit about school. One year I substituted over at St. Peter's. I started the year and they had a teacher hired that was going to graduate. So at the end of the, I think it was about January anyway, when he graduated from the university. Anyway, I was teaching over there, and that was the day of the Columbus storm, so it was 1961. And we knew we'd been, that the wind was coming up, but nobody'd been informed that there was really, really a bad wind coming. So school was dismissed. We dismissed the kids, which was a foolish thing to do. And the principal, and these were also nuns, said, just go home and there won't be any school tomorrow the way this wind's blowing. And so I started home and the wind was blowing like crazy. I could see branches falling off of trees and shingles going off of roofs, people trying to tie down bushes and so on. Well, I got across town and started down Game Farm Road, and there was one car ahead of me. Now, it was still light out at this time, so it was probably about 4 o'clock when this, and maybe it was 4:30, quarter of 5 the time I got over there. And the man in the car ahead of me, he came back and he said, we got to stop. He said, there's wires across the road, electric wires and telephone wires. And he said, we don't know what's live wires or what. So he said, we're just going to have to set. Well, I think that we ended up about 6 cars out of us out there. And there was a lady in the car behind me. She got up and come and sat with us. And we sat out there, oh, I don't know how long. I don't know why we didn't turn around and go back somewhere. But anyway, well, I do know, because there was wires and came down behind us, so we were just pinned in between 2 sets of wires. And it was dark. It was, probably 8 o'clock anyway, before we got out of there. And while we were sitting there, Kenny had been on a run, and I didn't know where he was. And I just imagined that Bill and... all the kids, Bill was about 3, yeah, and he, Frieda Carpenter was babysitting him, and she was only a block from school, so I just hoped that the other 3 kids walked down there to her house, which they did, but I didn't know where they were, and they sure didn't know where I was. That's when we needed cell phones. So finally, I guess they were electricians or somebody. They came and took those wires away, and they did happen to be live wires. And so I went on down to Carpenter's, but on the way, the road, you could just, some places just hardly get through because of the branches and so on. And the wind had died down. And when I got to Frieda's, Kenny had been there and picked up the kids. Now, how he got, he was just in his pickup, and how he got all 4 of them in that pickup, I don't know, but he did. And he went home, and we had no power, and he said that when he'd got home, the shingles were coming off of the roof just like you were pouring cornflakes out of a box. And I guess the kids kind of thought it was exciting because he got the camping gas lantern out, and I think it must have been soup. Anyway, he got the camp stove out because the electric stove didn't work, and all they could do was just sit there and wait and wonder. Well, when I started from home from Frieda's, was in the middle of Springfield, I could go down one street, and then it would be block of tree limbs. Then I'd have to go down an alley, and then back to there. And finally, I got to the highway, could only go up in some places about 10 miles an hour because there was so much trash and so on the roads. And some places you even had to drive over some of these branches. Well, anyhow, everybody was safe, but during that storm there were some people that were killed. Well, one of them I know fell off of a roof. The wind had blown them down. And it took a while to get it all cleaned up. I think we missed about 2 or 3 days of school. And another thing I really didn't like, I taught at Leeburg, had schools at that time. And it was a little school. And it was right, the Mackenzie River goes right behind the schoolhouse. And for some stupid reason, they have a picnic across the river. And the only way to get across that river is to go across the swinging bridge. And when you started on this bridge, it'd swing. And of course, the kids that live close had run back and forth across that with just hang on to the sides, and it didn't bother them. Well, when I started on there, the swing started swaying a little bit, and I hung on tight, and the kids ahead of me were going fine, and the ones behind me, they were hurry up. Well, my group got across pretty near about halfway. One little girl sat down on the bridge. Now, there's this bridge was just made out of ropes, but it did have some kind of protection up so you wouldn't slide out either way, supposedly. Well, anyway, I looked down and that river looked a long ways away and it was going pretty fast. Well, she sat down and I told her, I said, oh, you've got to get up. I said, we got to get across this bridge. And she says, I'm scared. I'm not going to get up. Well, I knew I wasn't going to let go of that bridge myself with one hand. And so the kids behind us was going around, and they tried to get her to get up. And she says, I'm not getting up. So they went on around, and I told them, I said, you tell Mr. Austin he's got to come back and get us. And so when they got across, why, the principal came back, and he talked her into standing up that he'd take her hand. We got across, had the picnic, and I thought, now we got to go cross that bridge to get back to the schoolhouse. Well, it was uneventful. And you know what? The very same thing happened another time I was up there, except nobody sat down. But we went across that bridge. I've been across that bridge twice. I don't know if it's still there or not, but I never went over it again. I think there was one thing I didn't tell about Bob, and he was over here the other day and reminded me of it. Okay, he was in kindergarten, and he was waiting for me after school. And where Bill was, I don't know, because they were in school at the same time. But there were a couple boys, I imagine they were probably fifth or sixth graders, and they got to talking to Bob, and they got to telling him all dirty words and swear words and so all this. And Bob was listening, and he didn't know what they were saying. And then they told him to call his dad a dirty name. And so when I picked him, Bob up, well, he told me what these boys were saying. So the next morning, I took Bill and him at the front door, and I said, you take Bob to kindergarten, and I'm going in to talk to this teacher, the principal. And so I told her what had happened, and this was Sister Rita, and the strict one. And I guess when those two boys come to school, Bob said that the door to the kindergarten room opened, and she had each one of them by the ear, one on each side of her. And she asked Bob, is this the two boys that talked to you? And Bob said, yeah, he was. So anyhow, those two boys weren't allowed in the school all day except maybe to come in and go to the bathroom. They had to set out on the step in front until they apologized to me. And the sister told him, she said, even if by chance she doesn't come and somebody else picks up the boys tonight, you won't be in school tomorrow. You'll be sitting right out here on this step. And just entry into school, they sat there. And I guess it was kind of warm, and they sat there. And I know they were thinking, she wouldn't let them go home. I don't know if the folks come and got them or if they walked close enough, but the two of them were sitting there on the step when I came. And she had made him write an apology to me and then went to Kenny. And they come running over to the car and they were sorry. And she had already told him, you have to write more than I'm sorry on those apologies. And so I kind of scolded the boys. I said, you know, that it wasn't very... I didn't appreciate them talking to Bob that way. And besides that, he didn't even know what they were talking about and so on. And of course, and I said, and the only reason that I'm accepting your apologies, I think that you need to be in school sitting out rather than sitting out here on this bench or well on the step. And so they were pretty quiet boys for a long, long time. And I don't know if they ever talked to Bob again or not. So that's kind of, oh, and I belong to American Businesswomen for about, 40 years. And that's a professional organization. Headquarters happened to be in Kansas City and so on. And we got this letter, and it was called Self-Improvement by Personalysis or something like that. And what it was forms, and they'd sent 10. And I was supposed to give 5 of them to somebody that I worked for or with. And the other 5 was to be given either to a coworker or a professional friend. And a lot of it was just checks, you know, things, this, how school performance or work performance or whatever. Or if they had anything to say, they could say it. And so I thought, well, that might be kind of interesting to do to see what how you're rated in your work. And so I picked 5 principals that I had talked quite a bit with, and then 5 teachers that I knew. And definitely none of them went to Eugene. You can bet on that. So you never knew who said what or anything. It was a percentage then. It was sent back, but it was like a work performance or something like that. Then they could put 50%, 90% or whatever they wanted to say. Well, anyway, when I got mine back, why, it was 98%. And there was nothing that said what I could do. And I thought, well, I wonder who didn't give me 100%. But anyway, it made me feel pretty good. But I did like to substitute. I love to substitute. It's not for everybody, but I liked it. And now I'm going to tell a little story that I heard, and I presume it was true, about one of my favorite nieces, of all of them, nieces were favorite. But anyway, this one, as the story goes, was riding in the back of a pickup with her friends, and they were throwing rotten tomatoes, or maybe they were just ripe tomatoes. But anyway, they were throwing them out. Now, what they were aiming at or whether they were just throwing them, I don't remember that story. And then another time, she and her friend decided they'd have their head shaved. Well, the friend went first, and she did, but my niece backed out. And I think that's one time I couldn't have stuck up for her, because she had long, beautiful hair. And then I think it was a school reunion that he had for her. She came down, and it was at the Elks. And even though none of our kids were involved, they were having this dance at the Elks, and Kenny said, maybe we ought to go over and check out what's going on at the Elks tonight, see how that party is. So we went over, and Kenny danced a dance or two with her, and then we come home, and then late at evening, or maybe it was even morning, she came over and slept all night on the couch. And the couch is still there, and Elk's Lodge is still there. So whenever you want to come back and sleep on that couch, we will go to the Elks, and you're more than welcome. And so, you know, teenagers can have a lot of fun, can't they? Okay. The next thing is when we moved from our house to in Eugene over to Springfield, and we didn't have too much furniture. I think maybe I told you before that we bought this dryer, and that was the first thing we bought. And so we took it out there, and so we just kind of got done with what we had, except we did buy two kind of easy chairs. One, I think, was a rocker, and one was just kind of a stuffed chair. And it was at some kind of a wholesale house in Eugene. And when we were in there, they had a dining room table. And I really liked it. The seats had white leather flecked with gold on them. I knew that right then we couldn't do it. So anyway, we bought those. And so we hadn't been settled in there too long. And I told Kenny, I said, I knew they cost a little over $100. And I told Kenny, I said, if I teach a week of school, I said, can we buy one of those? And like I said, this table and chairs cost a little over $100. And at that time, I think substitutes only got just about $19 a day. And he said, yeah, if you teach a week of school, why? He said, you can buy your table and chairs. Well, you know, it wasn't very long till the end of the month I got my check. And it was a little over $100. Well, he said, and we both knew that Linda's $40 tuition came before anything else. And he said, well, he said, Teamsters are really talking strike. And he said, so maybe we better put that money in the bank in case they do go on strike, so we'll have money to pay for Linda's tuition. So, and I agreed with him, that was right. And so, I said, okay. I said, if I teach another week of school, can we get it then? Yeah, if you do. Well, next month, I taught another week of school, and the Teamsters were on strike. So Kenny had a mail run, so his job wasn't, he still worked. But he said, you know, he said, we're on strike. And he said, I'm driving right now. But he said, if somebody with more seniority decides to bump me off my run, he said, they might be able to do it. So he said, whatever you think. I said, okay, we'll put this check in the bank. And so we were eating breakfast one morning. And when we moved over there, when we moved from Eugene, we sold our little gas stove, the heating stove, and we sold the gas tank and all this. But we still had two propane bottles that we got when we first moved in there. And we talked about them before, about those bottles we needed to do something with, because they were just sitting against the against the garage. And so that one morning, I said, you know, if I sell those two bottles, then we'll buy this. So yeah, he said, yeah, you can sell those two bottles. He said, but remember, he said, we paid $50 for them. And he said, I don't think you're going to get any $100 for them bottles. And do you know, 2 days later, I was just supposed to have that table and chairs. 2 days later, a fella driving down the highway stopped, and he came to the door, and he said, I'm looking at your gas bottles out there. He said, do you have propane gas? And I said, no, we used to, but I said, we still have those bottles. He said, well, would you be interested in selling them? And I thought, boy, am I. And he said, what would you take for them? And I said, well, we didn't use them very long. And I said, we paid $50 for them. And he said, well, will you sell them to me for $50 or for $100? And I said, I sure will. And I think it was $120 he gave me. And so when Kitty came home that night, he got off at 11. And, of course, it was dark when he came in. And when he got up the next morning, I said, we're going to go buy a table and chairs today. And he said, you didn't sell those bottles. I said, yes, I did. And I showed him the 100, I think it was 120, 125. Needless to say, he knew there was no putting me off this time. So we went over and bought the table and chairs. And we had them for a long time. We moved over here at our house here between Springfield and Eugene. But he never lost his job as on strike or anything. But anyway, I had my table and chairs. Okay, and lately, Linda just had her birthday, and I've been thinking about her, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about Linda today. When she was started hospital school, like I said, and I don't know whether this was the first year she was there or the second year. But one day, a couple boys from the Arcacia, I think is how you say it, fraternity in Corvallis, came down to Children's Hospital where she was at. And they talked to the administrator and they told him that they were looking for a handicapped little girl to be their sweetheart for the year. And so they wanted to know if they could visit the classrooms and so on. And of course, the administrator took them. And when Linda came home from school that day, when she was carrying, her bus driver was carrying a bouquet of flowers. And I said, what's all this about? And then he told me. He said, well, they had visitors to school today from the Corvallis fraternity, and they chose Linda to be their sweetheart for the year. Well, then they called me from school and told me about it, and they wanted to know if it was okay with us and so on, and what these boys had chosen Linda. Of course, Linda was real excited because she'd got flowers and they talked to her and all this. And so in a few days, we got Linda got a letter from the fraternity, and it said that she had been chosen as their sweetheart, and that there would be a crowning and a formal banquet. Anyway, they put it in there some way, I don't know. Anyway, a banquet, and then her parents and her teacher and husband were invited. And so they came down again, and they brought Linda a little white organdy dress, which was quite a ways too big for her. So Ann Sage came in, and she and I went shopping for Linda a dress, and we found one that was blue, and light blue and white. And of course, Linda liked it because it was blue. And Linda said, or Anne said, well, before Linda goes up to there, she says, I want to curl her hair and so on for her. And so when the banquet came, Anne had came in and fixed her hair for her. And her teacher and husband came over and picked us up, and we went up there to Corvallis. And when we went in to the banquet room, there were signs all over with hearts hanging all over where the banquet was. And, hearts. And then they had a table. And there was Linda's teacher, and of course Linda had a spatial chair, and us, and I think there was four. Anyway, there were officers in the fraternity. And when they served the banquet, Linda wouldn't need a thing. And so one of these boys said, what would you eat? You can have anything you want. We'll get you anything you want to eat. And I thought, well, now what's she going to say? And I don't know for sure, but I wouldn't surprise me saying that it was a root beer float, because root beer floats were one of her special. And where they got a root beer float, or whatever they got, I wondered at the time. But they got it, and I think Linda did eat it. Well, after the banquet, then we went into the ballroom, and it might have been in their gym or something, I don't know, but it was a pretty big room. And it was pretty crowded because the fraternity was there, and their dates for the night. And of course, like I say, it was on the invitation formal. So I did have a formal that I'd wore. Oh, I don't know, somebody's wedding before we come out here, but I could still wear it. So I had a formal, and so did her teacher. And when we went in, to this ballroom, when Linda sat down by us, and two boys come over, and they were her escorts, and they told Linda, told Linda, each one of them took hold of her arm, and then they'd walk across, and there was kind of a little stage or platform, and on it was her chair, and it was all lined with red velvet. And so they helped her sit down, and they told her, and while they were doing this, it was one of the officers was explaining to the congregation that this year they had picked their sweetheart from Children's Hospital School and introduced Linda. And they told them what their fraternity was and what it was all about and so on. And in the meantime, these guys, I don't know what they were telling Linda, but they were getting her settled down. And she was in this chair. And they told Linda that since she was their sweetheart for the year, she needed to be crowned. So they put a silver crown on her, and then they said, she said, our fraternity, we have pins, and when we have a sweetheart, we give our sweetheart one of our pins, and since you're our sweetheart for the year, we want you to have one of our fraternity pins. So they said, could we pin it on your dress? And she said, well, yes. And so they pinned it on her dress, and then they said, And since you're our sweetheart, you need a staff. And so it wasn't exactly a cane, but it was kind of similar to a cane. They handed her that, and they said, now you can take this cane, or this staff, they called it, and you can tell your friends at school about it. And so they crowned her, and then they went over and said something to the band. And I don't know for sure what the mute song was, but it was something like, Let Me Call You Sweetheart, or maybe it been that, I'm not sure. But anyway, they played that song, and these boys had made a chair out of their hands, and Linda sat on their hands and her arms around their neck, and they carried her around that dance floor a couple times. And while they were doing this, the other boys had moved her velvet chair over there by her teacher and I. So anyway, they brought her over and set her down, and we stayed for a few dances and watched them. And then Kenny told the boys, you know, it was getting kind of late, and she was getting tired. So we went home, and this was one of the highlights. And during that school year, they did come down two or three times. One time they took her out and got a Coke, and they'd always bring her flowers. And she was, you know, like I say, she was either six or seven. Okay, also, then when she was going to Children's Hospital School, they had, it was on Lake Silicus over at the coast, and it was Easter Seal Camp. A doctor had a lodge over there at one time and donated this property and the lodge to Easter Seal. And they made it a camp for the handicapped. The first year, any handicapped, then there were a few kids that were over there that were a little bit retarded and so on. They only let them go the 1 year, and after that, it was strictly crippled kids mostly. And they went over there on scholarships, or I really don't know what it cost them to go, because every year that Linda went, and I think she went four times, she had somebody sponsor her. And the first year she went, the fraternity from Corvallis were her sponsors. And when they went to this camp, we took her over, I think, on a Saturday. And the only way into this camp was by boat. I mean, and they had no telephones. And I really thought, more than once, do I want to leave Linda over here? Well, when they got on the boat, and it was more kind of like it was a speed boat, but it was kind of, it wasn't exactly a raft, but they could take more than, they could take several on there. Maybe, I don't know. Anyway, we got over there. And this lodge that they went in, it was kind of where this doctor had lived, but they'd also put up some cabins and kind of a dorm. And the kids at night would stay there, and I think there was four kids to a room, and then they had two attendants in there with them. And they had a lot of college kids. I know some of them worked for credit, some of them volunteered. But anyway, it was well staffed. And those kids, they could go in the lodge, or in the lodge, and they ate in there. And there's a big fireplace, and if they wanted to listen to stories or something like that, they could stay in the lodge. But most of the time, it was outdoors. And they went fishing, they rode their speedboats. And one of Linda's favorite things was they had a water slide, and they'd help them go up these stairs, and then they'd sit on a slide and they'd slide off of them. And the water wasn't very deep when they hit the water. And Linda liked this, but her main thing was fishing. They'd take them fishing pretty much every day. At night, sometimes they'd have outdoor theater, or they'd have hot dogs and roast marshmallows and so on. And she had a great time. And on Sunday, no, we took her over on Sunday and picked her up on Saturday. That's who it was. And she rode they rode the speedboat out. Well, finally, I think on her second or third year that she went over there, Why, they did put some kind of a road, and it was a terrible road. And we went over in the car to this road, and I swore we'd never do it again. A couple times going over, it must have been, oh, at least 5 or 6 miles by car to go over there. And I remember one year we went, they stopped us, and they set some dynamite off someplace, and the branches flew every which way. And that was the last year we took the car. But it was a great place that the kids could be out, and the deer came up, and they were more or less tame deer. The kids they could feed them, and which was kind of surprised me. But those deer, the kids had handed them something, and they'd eat. I think Linda went 4 times, and then when she was married, they went over for a reunion once, and we went to this, and we went on the boat, and Linda saw a lot of kids that she saw before. I don't think Steve enjoyed it too much, but Linda did. And she probably went longer, but for some reason, Easter Seal decided to sell it. And they would have day camps around Portland. And so that's what it turned out to be. They sold the camp, and if you went, you were only there for a day, and then you had to go home. Well, Ara and the parents from down here kind of thought, you know, this camp was great. It gave the kids a good time, and also it gave the parents a break. And some of them were a lot more handicapped than Linda was. But Kenny and them, before they sold the camp, they donated their time from the Moose Lodge. Kenny'd take a work crew over, or the camper club would work over there for a weekend and so on. So I know that they, Kenny helped build cabins and so on. But as far as I know, it was closed. Well, of course, Linda was getting a little older and didn't go, but when they closed the camp, like that stopped Linda's going. I mean, when they made it a one-day thing, and we got a letter once, and it said they appreciated our help and donation for the past 4 years. Well, this kind of made me mad. Kenny stayed a member of the I don't know what you call it, auxiliary or what, but he'd always send a donation to Camp Easter Seal. But I quit because I wrote him back and I said, you better make that 54 years instead of 4 years, because we had belonged to Easter Seal for 54 years at the time we got this letter. And so that was the end of that. Okay, then, I don't know, I think Linda probably was about 9, and I told you about the operation she'd had. Well, they put her in the hospital for this operation, and she was anemic. And so before she could have the surgery, they had to bring her blood up to where it belonged. And they gave her a shot in her breastbone, and Kenny's dad had had that, and he said nothing could be possibly hurt more than that shot. That needle seemed that long to me. But anyhow, Linda went home for about 2 weeks, and then she was scheduled again. So we took Nancy and Mike. Michael, I don't think Michael was walking yet, but anyway, we took them up, and Glenn and Enid kept them while she was in the hospital. Well, when they did this operation, when they brought Linda in, she had her shoes on, and there was a surgical steel I called it a bar or brace or something between them. And Linda's feet, I would say, they were that far. I would say maybe not 3 feet, but as far as Linda's legs would stretch. That's how far that was stretched. And they brought Linda in, and laid her on her back. And she was on her back for 4 hours, and then four attendants would come in, and they'd flip her over on her stomach. And she was on her stomach for 4 hours. And when they flipped her, it hurt so bad that her face just turned purple. But I guess it had to be. One thing, they didn't want the parents, the first day of surgery, the parents could stay all day and into the evening. After that, they said that when the parents came and left, why, the kids had cried too much and it was too hard on them, that they didn't want us to come back until Linda was ready to come home. Well, Linda wouldn't eat. And so they decided that I could come and feed her or see that she was there. So I was there pregnant all day long. And Kenny was on his shift that he got in at 11 o'clock. And when he'd sign out, he'd go down to that hospital and go in at 11 o'clock. And not once did they ever try to stop him or anything. Every night, and I imagine she was in the hospital 2 weeks. But I got to be there. And then there was, I think, three kids in her room. And one of them had a private nurse. And I knew the nurse. She went to St. Alice, and she said, I'll keep an eye on Linda too while I'm here. And so I know that Linda was watched. But when, I think it was the second or third day I was over there, and Linda had been complaining that her feet hurt. And she said, I just can't hardly stand it. They hurt so bad. So Dr. Digg came in, and I said, Linda's complaining about her feet hurting. And he said, her feet shouldn't be hurt. And I said, well, they are, and it's all that she can do to stand. So he said, we'll take those shoes off. And they took the shoes off. Linda's feet had been spastic, and there were blisters on both heels, and they were pretty near to the bone. And Dr. Digg was very unhappy. He said, she can't have those shoes back on. And they should have been looked at before. And I said, well, she's been complaining, you know, for 2 days, and it didn't do any good. Well, I imagine somebody got told pretty good. But anyway, they took the shoes off, but they fixed some kind of it wasn't exactly a rope, but some kind of a tie. And they would tie her feet to one side of the bed, and the other foot leg on the other side, and she was still flipped over every 4 days. And one of her highlights of the days, mother sent her a package. Every day she was there, I think there was 14 of them. And some days it was just like a coloring book or just some little nothing that it didn't matter. And after we took her home, we had to do exercising, stretching exercises for quite a long time. Now, whether this was done in the summer or not, I can't remember her missing any school, but she could have, I don't know. After that was the time that Enid and I went back to Kansas with Kenny's folks. I may have mentioned this before. And they, at this time, they'd put long braces on Linda from her foot down. So she stood up most of the way from Oregon to Kansas. And she stood in front of Enid. And she rode all the way back there to Kansas. We were only there a short time. But anyway, we got to Kansas and back. And when Linda was about 12, maybe 13, she flew from here to spend the summer with the grandparents. And we took her to the airplane. The way they load luggage with on that thing, they lift it all up on. Why, Linda got on the stand and they lifted her up. She didn't have to go up the stairs. And like Kenny was on the inside to see that, the airplane, to see that she was seated and so on. And then the grandparents, I think it was Mother and Kenny's mom, picked her up and Denver took her down. Well, then when it come time to come home, why, Esther, Kenny's sister, took her to Denver. Well, she wanted to ride the roller coaster. So Esther goes out to Leach's Gardens, and they had a roller coaster. And nothing like better than the carnival rides. Anyway, there was a long line, and Esther said, Linda, I think there's too many here. I don't think you'll be able to get on. She said, I'm not going home till I ride that roller coaster. And I know Esther two or three times said, you know, Linda, we got to go. We're going to miss the plane. Well, that didn't faze Linda at all. She wasn't going. So Esther went up and told the ticket taker and the one that was running the machines. He said, told him the case. And he said, well, come to the head of the line and we'll let you have the next seat that's open. And so she did. And Esther and her had the roller coaster, or Linda would have never got on that plane. So we picked her up here. And then right before she was went into junior high, and she was still going to, it was the year before she went in, why, she was still having therapy. And the doctor told us that if she would have surgery on her feet, they could, I don't know, do something to her heels, I think. Anyway, she wouldn't drag her toes as much, and she would be able to to wear plain shoes rather than her high-top shoes that she'd been wearing all these years. And we said, I told Linda, well, you know, it's up to you. You know how you suffered the other time. And if you want to do it, fine. If you don't, fine. Well, she didn't even give it a second thought. She said, I'll have the operation. Well, she did. And that time she was in school, but she had a home teacher for, well, I imagine 6 weeks anyway. And the kids at junior high, Hamlin, were very good to her. I can't remember us having a wheelchair here, but we must have, because the kids would push her in the wheelchair. And she was allowed, I don't know, five or six minutes to get from one class to the other. And maybe that's the reason they liked to push her, because they could miss 5 minutes of class. I don't know, but anyhow, she did. Okay, the next year she was ready for high school. And so we went to high school, and I don't know why, when we had to have this meeting with the counselor was there, and the principal, Bill O'Neill, was there. And maybe it was because a handicapped person was coming in or what, I don't know. But Linda wanted to take home ec, and they said, the principal said, no, that's definitely out, that the home ec room was upstairs. And she wouldn't be able to do it. We didn't say anything that year. Linda took what she was needed, and we would take her to school. Well, then they only had a 3-year high school, and she'd be a junior. And we went over, and same thing again. And some of the teachers were in there this time. So Linda, again, went at home ec, and O'Neill said, Linda, we already been through that. He said, you know, you're just not eligible to go up and down them stairs. And she said, and Linda said, I've already been up and down. And he said, you climbed those stairs over there? And I said, yes, she did. And the home ec teacher happened to be in there for, I don't know why, maybe Linda told her. But anyway, she was there, and he looked at the teacher, and he said, she's up there? And the teacher said, yes. She said, she just put those crutches up, slid them up her arm. She'd come right up those stairs and went all through the classroom and had no trouble going down. Well, he had nothing to say. He said, all right, all okay, and I'll allow it. And so I said, and while you're doing it, I said, we want her to ride the school bus to school. Oh, he said, we had to find everything we wanted. He said, oh, I don't think she can get in or out of that bus. But he said, I'll give it a try. I'll have them bring around a bus. And if she can get on it in 5 minutes, well, then she can ride. Well, they kind of made a mistake because we weren't right out of that room. We were right on the cement. It went right straight to the bus, and it was parked along the curb. So Linda just walked it over and went up the two steps into the bus. And she was up there as fast as probably, hey, he could do it. And so, okay, she could ride. And I said, not only that, I want my other three kids riding the bus. So, then he did hit the ceiling. He said, where do they go to school now? And I said, at Springfield Junior High and St. Alice. Oh, that can't be done. He said, you can't do that. I said, well, if my kids can't ride it, how come can the kids from Marcola ride it? He said, I didn't know they did. He said, where did they get off at? I said, right here to her front door. Well, he knew that if they could ride it, he couldn't very well tell me I couldn't or we couldn't. So he agreed, but he said, it's really a crowded bus. He said, they'll, till they get to Hamlin. Well, the bus driver was really good, but he wouldn't come down here and go right past here and up to Centennial. He had to go to Centennial straight up. And so, but Linda always had the front seat, and Bill was only 5 years old at the time, was kindergarten. And they'd hold him, one of the kids, but Mike and Nance had to stand up a lot. Not always, but a lot, till they got to Hamlin. And then they walked the rest of the way across. And so she had home ec then her senior year. When she graduated, after graduation, they had an all-night party. And everything in town, the skate rink, the swimming pool, the theater, everything was open to the seniors. They had breakfast and they had dinner right after school. And so Linda called Toby, and they had kept in close touch all these years on the phone constantly. And he asked her, and I'd ask him, Susan, would you like to be my date? We'll go to this all-night party. Well, yeah, that sounded great. So, but it's after graduation. Well, the graduation that year was outdoors. And Bill O'Neill finally did say, well, she can sit in the car during graduation. And then when they walk across the stage that they'd moved in, she can get up, and there was helpers that helped them up across the stage and then down. And she can walk across the stage and then get back in the car. Well, Linda said, and it was, you had to walk across, not the football field, but it was the grass before they got to the field, and then the rest of us set out the other way. And I can't remember just how it was done, but anyway, Linda said, I'll walk across it, and she did. She walked across the field and down, and I know that it almost brought blisters to her hands, but she never said a word about it. And so after graduation, we went back over to Hamlin for dinner, and her and Toby went in, And Kenny and I were chaperones, but we also had to work in the kitchen and help serve the dinner. So while we were finishing up, why she and Toby went back to where they were dancing. And of course, they were signing autographs and so on and doing all this talk and so on. Well, they were there. And so we said, well, where do you want to go? Well, they were ready to go. And I don't know where we went first, but then they decided they'd go to the theater. And I don't remember whether we stayed in the theater with them. I know we didn't sit with them. And we might have been at the back, I don't know, or we might have went somewhere else. But anyway, after the theater, I think the only places they didn't go was like we didn't go to the roller skating. We didn't go to the swimming pool. But anything they couldn't participate in, they wanted to see anyway. And so I don't suppose it was too awful long till 11 o'clock when they started serving breakfast. So I imagine we got over there probably about 11:30. And Kenny and I had to work in the kitchen again. Or we did anyways. So anyway, they had a sunrise service. Well, Linda and Toby were kind of thinking, hey, you know, we might stay to that sunrise service. Well, anyway, after they ate, I don't know, it was getting way after midnight, 1 o'clock, and they got them loaded up. They decided, well, Kenny said, you know, it's getting pretty late, and we got to take Toby clear across town. And besides that, you're having a party tomorrow afternoon. So they agreed that they'd go home, and we took Toby home. And then the next day, we had cake and so on for Linda, and friends came, and Toby came back again. So she had a good graduation, and she hadn't been home our school out very long, and she thought, well, it's time that I'm getting a job. And one of the places that she thought she'd go to was the library, because she had worked at the library at the high school, helping mend books and checking them in and going through them and doing any repair that they might need and so on. So I took her down to the library. And let me tell you, nobody ever, ever had a worse interview than she did. When we walked in, we went back to this office where the librarian was, and I never saw a person more rude than this woman. And the first thing she said, Linda, I'll tell you right off, you can't have the job because you can't qualify. She said, you can't stand on your feet as long as you would have to. She said, I'm the only one that can do that. And she pushed her chair back. She pulled out the drawer that was perched as high as her desk and crossed her feet. She says, I'm the only one that can come back here and do this and sit here like this. Well, I didn't say anything. Then she started telling all the things that Linda couldn't do. And she said, just what made you think that you could work here? And so Linda told her some of the things she did at high school. And she said, you could probably do that. But she says, there's not much of that to do anyway. And I said, Linda, I don't think you want to work here. And Linda said, I know I don't. And so we got up and walked out. And if there was anybody that I could have turned that person into, I would have done it. But I didn't know who I could do it to. So she went over to the school office, and she got a job there. And I don't know for sure what all she did do, but she worked there about 2 years. And there was she kind of had a sponsor, I guess you'd call her, or something. Anyway, she came over and she said that she had a place in, I think it was Salem, she said, you might be interested in. But she didn't tell us what it was. And we thought maybe it was some kind of work or something. So she came over and she took Linda and I up there. And when we went in, I think there was this woman was from drove a state car. And she was really nice, and she took us in, and I think what it was a place that for kids just to get away from home, and there was just no job to it. And I said, well, I don't think that's what Linda's looking for. And at the same time, shortly afterwards, we heard about the cerebral palsy workshop in Portland. So she was real interested in that. So we took her up there and we went through it with her, and she liked it. She liked the way it looked. And so they hired her. Well, then she got a room at it was called the Ondine Apartments, and it was a hotel for women only. And they'd let Kenny go just to the lobby of the hotel. And there was a restaurant down there, too. So her moving in, why they'd let Bob, he was only about, I think, about six. And they'd let Bob help carry things up. And so she went up, and about all her room up there amounted to, I think there was two of them. She had a roommate. Each one of them had a dresser, and it was just kind of a dorm-like. And then downstairs was a restaurant where they could eat. And so that's where she stayed. But she left out one of the women that worked in the office over at the workshop. I don't know whether she lived in the Ondine or whether she had an apartment close. But anyway, she'd pick Linda up in the morning and take her home at night. So Linda did have transportation back and forth. And she worked on an assembly line to start with. And I don't know whether they had a new superintendent or anyway, supervisor or what, but Linda had been working there quite a while. And this fellow, I guess he'd come over and he'd stand behind him and watch him work. And Linda said, I just turned around and told him, go on, I know what I'm doing. I guess he did. But anyhow, she worked there, I suppose maybe a year anyway, in Eldon, that she'd known back in Children's Hospital School. They got acquainted again and started going together. They came down on the bus and told us that they were going to get married. And in a way, that was kind of a shock. And I said, well, when? Well, they hadn't been to talk to the probate judge yet, but they wanted to know if we wanted to come up to the wedding and so on. So we were sent there, and Kenny knew I didn't like the idea about it. And I said, well, if you're going to get married, what would you think about having a church wedding? I said, we'll give you a church wedding if that's what you want. Well, that sounded really, really good. So I don't know whether they set the date. I don't know whether Linda took a leave of absence or what, but she was down here for a while. And because Anne helped us get her veil and I don't know what all. And then they come down for the rehearsal. And the priest told her, she said, Linda, well, you can just sit on the front row. And then when you just walk from there, your dad can take you from there. And she said, no. She said, I want to walk up that aisle. I want to walk up that aisle. So Toby was best man, and Nancy was her bridesmaid, and they did. Kenny walked her down the aisle, and it was mostly just family, and I don't know, I suppose maybe there was, besides his family and all of us, and then close friends from both of them. His folks lived in Coos Bay, I think, at the time, Reedsport, and they were here. So anyway, they got married, and then they all come back over here, and we had I don't know who else. I mean, we had a cake and kind of a little reception and so on. And I didn't know it at the time that they planned it, but they got all kinds of wedding gifts. I mean, a lot. And they opened the gifts and so on. And then the next day, while we took Linda and Steve back to Portland, and all our stuff, was a good thing we had a station wagon. And they'd rent an apartment, and I don't know, it must have been close enough that they could get to the workshop, because they worked there, both of them worked there for, I don't know, quite a while. I guess they were, I don't know, they were married, I think, about 2 years, and then they got a divorce. It just wasn't working out, and really, I kind of think maybe it was just a way to get away from home at the time. I don't know. But anyhow, I don't know. I guess probably, it might have been two years later. Why, right before that, where we went up and got Linda's things and moved her into an apartment. And it was close enough that, and I guess somebody took her from there too, because she never seemed to have any trouble with transportation. But anyhow, I guess one day, it was at workshop, somebody was giving her a bad time, some guy. And I don't know whether he was teasing her, I don't know what it was all about. Steve didn't tell me that part, but he said somebody was giving Linda a bad time. And he said, I knew who Linda was, but he said, we didn't really know each other. And he said, I was standing close enough to listen to this. And he said, that's when I learned to stay away from that cane. He said, Linda took a swing at the guy with the crutch. And Steve said, she missed him, but hit me. And that's how Steve and Linda got acquainted. And I don't know how long after that it was that, Steve and Linda got married. They got married in the workshop there, and they did this wedding themselves, the two of them. And we were on our way to Kansas. We went up to the wedding and the reception that they had planned, and then we went to Kansas. And I think Linda kind of hated it. She wasn't going to Kansas with us, but anyhow, the two of them worked at the workshop, and then they had apartments. And while they were living there, why, Linda took a driver's license test. Of course, she couldn't drive a car, but they bought a golf cart, and she had to have a driver's license to drive this golf cart. And we went up there and seen her once, and I would just held my breath, because she'd go to the crosswalk or end of the street and look both directions, and then she'd just really tear across that street on that golf cart. And I don't think she ever drove it to work, but they went to parks and so on with it. And then Steve told me that she took a class in CPR? Okay. She took a class in that, and he said she passed it with 90%. And so I didn't know that she'd done that, but she worked at the workshop, and this was after they were married. Well, we got a letter that they were going to have it wasn't exactly a referral. I don't know. I guess it was kind of bring us up to date what Linda done and what she wanted in the future and so on. So anyway, they invited us to come up, and Linda, it was several weeks down the way, and Linda and Steve had come down here, and it came up, and we had mentioned it, and Linda didn't know about it. She said, I don't know, they hadn't told me about any meeting or anything like that. And I knew she was a little perturbed. But anyway, when the time came, we went up, and Steve wasn't invited. He wasn't there, it was just Linda. And she sat there, and they went through the caseworkers and what she'd done and so on. And then they asked Linda if she had anything to say, and she said, yes, I do. And I thought, oh, I knew. I kind of knew what was coming. And she said, I'm glad my folks are here. But she said, I don't appreciate them or anyone else knowing about this meeting before it was scheduled with me. And she said, I'm over 21, I'm married. And she said, I think I should have been notified first. Oh boy, did she give it to him. And Kenny was sitting next to her, and he was, Linda, that's enough. He was always shushing us. And she said, I just want them to know how I feel, she said. And of course, they really apologized. And the one that was in charge of the meeting said, well, you know, it must have been a mistake. You were, you know, that you weren't notified first, so on, and before the date was set, and so on. Well, she wasn't. And then they asked Linda, she said, well, is there anything that you'd like to say? Well, she said, you know, they've always, and they were people that worked here, sometimes could work someplace else and then come back. And she said, I always wanted to work for the police department. And Toby wanted to work for the disc jockey. Well, neither one of them ever got that. But when Linda went back, and she hadn't worked on the line for a long time, but they put her in charge of the telephones, and so she was the telephone operator and director, I think, for four telephones she had. And they worked there until they moved to Menville, and she didn't work when she went there. But when they were up there, there was a lot of things that Linda liked to do. One of her main things was Texas wrestling, and they went to the wrestling matches. And she and Michael really got into it more than once, and Michael did just a teaser. He told her they were all put on, and she knew they weren't. And when they were still in Portland, they'd go to all these matches, and Linda, one of the times she was there, why, she saw somebody that was working backstage that had gone to school with her in St. Alice. So she called him over, and she said, do you suppose it's possible for me to meet these wrestlers? She said, we come to all the matches, and I'd like to meet them. He said, well, I think it could be arranged. And so he took her and Steve backstage, I guess you'd call it, and she did. She met all of them that wrestled and got to know their names, and she always had a front row. When the matches, she always got to go first row, and they gave them a pass so they could go. Well, then, of course, they never missed any of them. And we went with them once, and she didn't use her cane or her crutch or anything that time, but Steve said she had before, and we saw others and poke these wrestlers through the ropes and so on with them. But I do know that Linda hollered and yelled at him. And I know she embarrassed Steve, but that didn't matter. This is what she liked to do. Linda, like we said before, she liked carnival rides, and she was kind of the daredevil of the bunch. Nothing she liked better was to ride behind Mike on his motorcycle. And she did this a lot. And then they went to the state fair. You know, Kenny and I never ever went to the state fair. And I don't think she ever missed many of these state fairs. And she collected bears. She got her first bear at her first, when she was a year old, she got her first bear, and she started collecting them. And she had over 450 of them. I mean, all kinds. And some of them were about an inch high, and they were carved out of wood. And on their on their front porch, they had a cement grizzly bear that was, between 4 and 5 feet tall. He's still there today, as far as I know. And let's see, what else did she like to do? Oh, I went that time, her and Steve came down, and they went to the Moose Lodge with us. And that night, they had an Elvis Presley impersonator there. Well, Elvis Presley was one of her favorite, what do I want to call, musicians or whatever they were. Anyway, she had all these records. And he played this guitar the first time and walked around the dance hall and sang. Well, when that song was over, he went back and talked to the band about something. And he went over, when he came over, he didn't say anything to Linda, and he said, "You're going to dance this one with me." And she kind of looked at him, and he took the scarf from around his neck and tied it around her neck, and the band began to play, and he began to sing. He took a hold of the back of her wheelchair. She was in a wheelchair at this time, and he wheeled her around. He tipped her back, and he wheeled her all around that whole song, and then brought her back to where we were, and he said, "What's your favorite color?" And she said, "Blue." He said, "Well, then you need another scarf." So he reached in his pocket, pulled out a blue one, tied that around her neck. Well, you know, that made her, it pleased Linda, too. And of course, everybody that was sitting around was really congratulating her. And then he came over and talked to her two or three different times. And she probably swore it was Elvis Presley, anybody to ask her. Okay, besides, she collected Elvis Presley records, and she liked the Beach Boys, the Monkees, and the Beatles. And one of her favorite songs were Pretty Lady, and she played that record a lot. But her very favorite one was Leader of the Pack. And she played Leader of the Pack. That was her favorite record. On Nancy's, no, Danielle, on the day that Danielle got married, I was putting some makeup on her, some rouge, and she had a round spots, and it wasn't really a bump, it was just a kind of a welt like. And I said, "Is that sore?" And she said, "No." And I said, "Well, you better have that looked at when you get back to Portland." Well, they waited a couple months of that, because that was, I think, in August, and I think it was probably October. They went to the dentist, and he said, "It looks like maybe some bones or some something was left from a tooth. Maybe it worked its way up and caused this." Well, I don't know how long they took to decide that wasn't it. Anyway, they took a blood test, and they found out that Linda had cancer. And it was progressed quite a ways, got into her bloodstream. Well, Joyce and her were always pretty close. Joyce said, "Well, if they give Linda therapy or chemo and she loses her hair," she said, "I'll shave my head." I said, "No." I said, "Don't do that," because I said, "She'll wear a wig or something if she needs it." But Joyce bought her a Davy Crockett hat, a fur hat, and it had a big, big long tail on it. And Linda fell in love with that hat. And I told her, I said, well, why don't you at least take the tail off? No, she wore it that way. And everywhere she went, she wore that hat. Well, I don't think that Linda ever, she might have had one chemo, I don't know. She didn't have more than that. And we went up to one examination, and the doctor came in and made the remarks. And he didn't say, how are you, or anything. He just talked a little bit, and he said, there won't be any more, or there won't be any more chemo treatments. And he left, and I went out and followed him out. And I said, pretty bad, huh? And he said, she might have 4 days, she might have 4 weeks, she might have 4 months, 4 years. You never know. But he said, chemo's not going to help her any, and why make her sick? And so she never, ever had any more chemo. And I don't know how long she lived. And one thing about Linda, when we moved to Oregon, she always wanted life insurance. Well, she wasn't eligible for any life insurance. Well, Dad had made an agreement with us before we went out here that he'd get 2 cows for Linda, and they'd have calves, and she'd sell that calves each year, and then Dad would deposit the money back there. And as long as we didn't use any of her money, why, he wouldn't charge us any thing for the grass and the pasture for the cattle. Well, she finally got down to one cow, and then after she was married, they let it go. But that money, I don't care how much they needed money, she would not spend that money because that was her life insurance. Well, then when she passed away, her life insurance was spent on the funeral, and she had enough money saved that she bought the 2 mausoleum places, and the funeral was pretty well taken care of. And so it was a big funeral. And Bill read the obituary, and he said that Linda was just like the rest of them. He said, we all had chores to do. We all had jobs to do. And Linda did them. And he said, we treated Linda just as mean as we treated each other. But he said, we knew when to stay back from the canes. And the last song they played at that song was Leader of the Pack.